I can't do it. Okay. We'll do it live.
Okay.
Do it live! I'll write it and we'll do it live!
Legacy Maker, the All Sports Network, presents a SIRTOBA Media production where the struggle is real to be awesome.
What? Than you, and you know it.
Hello, everyone. We are live for episode 2 of the KAYFABE Express. I am your host, Drew Willingham, along with this week's very special guest. And you know what? I think I'm going to let him introduce himself. Let's go ahead and see who this is.
The Golden Boy, Greg Anthony here. You may remember me from such things as being the best of the best, or the EWE Heavyweight Champion.
Were you watching the same match that I was? Were you? Did you see the fact that I had him pinned in the middle of the ring?
Well, I'm telling you, expect the unexpected. And that's me, walking out as I walked in. The EWE Heavyweight Champion.
Every person's ever bought a ticket, every person's ever changed a channel and saw me on the television, they remember who I am and what I'm about. This right here. The junior heavyweight title, the most important junior heavyweight title in the world.
And when the Golden Boy Greg Anthony makes a promise, it's as good as gold.
Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please welcome the Golden Boy Greg Anthony.
How's it going, guys?
Hey, man, thank you for being here today and for taking time to discuss your wrestling career, you know, life outside of it, and just what led you up to this point. And, you know, we've definitely got a lot of things to dive into. And I'd like to start off with, you know, what inspired you as a young man right here named Anthony to become a professional wrestler? I mean, we're all fans, you know, of the sport. We're all fans of the entertainment aspect of it as well. What led you to become a professional wrestler like you are today?
Well, pull that picture back up for a second. I'm wearing a wrestling shirt. I've got a Road Warriors bandana on. I've got my wrestling figures with my ring, my WCW thing. I've got a ramp. I've got a title belt. And I'm actually watching wrestling on the television at the same time. So for me, you know, that was my life growing up. I was such a huge wrestling fan as a kid and coming up. And my grandmother and I were really the only two wrestling fans. And we bonded over that. And there's Megan. That's probably the closest to abs I ever had, by the way. But even there, you know, I've got the pull that picture back. I've got the Bad News brown glove on. I've got the Road Warriors bandana on again. I've got the Ultimate Warrior wrestling buddy. And these shorts, I made my mom buy these shorts for me because they reminded me of the Dynamic Dudes.
Mm-hmm.
So yep. I was always a very creative child in that sense. And I always wanted, you know, I always wanted to be a part of it. It was just something that I was attracted to. And like, I can't explain it really. It was something that it hooked me very early on.
Now with the war going on between WCW and WWF in the 90s and how that, you know, because we're closer in age than most of the people that I'm going to have on this show over the couple coming weeks, right? You know, that drew us all in those generations into wrestling. Did that really have an effect on the trajectory of where you are today as far as seeing all that stuff playing out on TV?
You're talking about the Attitude Era itself?
Mm-hmm.
Well, for the Attitude Era, you know, obviously, you know, it was perfect for me because it was geared towards that 18 to 34 year old. You know what I mean? So it was a little more, had a little more of an edge to it, a little more risque and things like that. At the time, I thought it was the greatest thing ever, you know, and then as I got older and, you know, now I'm 41 years old and I run my own wrestling company and I'm a father and a husband, all that kind of stuff. You know, I realized that the Attitude Era didn't have the longevity or the shelf life that you want professional wrestling to have. Like, you look at stuff like the 80s stuff, for instance. The 80s stuff is almost timeless. You know what I mean? You could play it today and it's not going to offend anybody. It's not going to do anything. It's just old school professional wrestling. That Attitude Era stuff was a time capsule of the era that it was in. It was Jerry Springer. It was that shock jock kind of thing going on. There's no way that kind of material could work today. You know what I mean?
Nope.
So it, like, for me, it was a fun time and I'm glad we had it. And it was an interesting time. But at the same time, you know, I'm still more of a fan of the territory days and professional wrestling that can, you know, I can watch a match from Luthez, you know, today, and I could go out and I could do that same exact match at my shows and it would still work. You know what I mean? So that's kind of where I've always been with my mindset.
And I kind of wanted to chop that up a little bit at the beginning, because when I go back and watch your matches, I do get that feel of like the 80s style wrestling. Yeah, yeah. When I see that, especially with your unique finisher, which we'll get to here in a little bit, which is one that I haven't seen anybody match, you know, the quality of the thought behind that. But before we get to that, you know, speaking of, you know, growing up with wrestling and you as an avid historian, tell us a little bit about like your collection, like this, that you've got, you know, that you're holding on to, that has helped, you know, inspire you to get into this as well.
Yeah, I've always been kind of a pack rat. I mean, you can kind of see behind me, you know, this is the wrestling room, but it's got all kinds of junk in it right now. Where I'm constantly collecting something or something. So I've always been a pack rat in that sense of, you know, keeping things. If my mom wouldn't have thrown them away when I was at school one day, I would still have the backs to the wrestling figures that I had, because I kept all the backs that had all the information on it, like the height, weight, hometown stuff. I kept all the backs to every wrestler that I got back in the day. You know?
Wow.
You know?
That's another thing. Like, not many people do that. I mean, it's just like the same as keeping like an action figure with all the contents and everything and not opening it like you have on your wall behind
you. I do that now, but when I was a kid, obviously, I opened all my figures because I wanted to play with them. So, mm-hmm. but I kept that backing, you know, just for the information purpose. Oh yeah, that's great. I need that. So like, that's kind of the thing. I have all kinds of stuff here. I have, you know, one of the main things I have is James Beard, who is a famous ref from the Dallas territory. He actually gave me a chair from the Dallas Sportatorium.
Now that's really cool.
Yeah.
Especially with the history there in the Dallas Sportatorium.
Yeah. And I was watching a video not long ago and like, I think Terry Gordy picked up a chair and was like holding it over his head. And it was like my exact chair. It was like, oh, okay. That's pretty cool. And then I've got two chairs from the Mid-South Coliseum. I've got a WrestleMania chair. I've got, you know, a towel from Madison Square Garden. You know, I've got some of the programs you saw. Like, I've got a program from 1948 with Orville Brown in it, which is the first NWA World Heavyweight Champion. You know, him as champion in 1948, which is pretty cool. You know, I just got a bunch of stuff. You know, some stuff like I bought Mongo McMichaels' Chicago Bears rookie card because, you know, I thought that would be a fun thing to have. You know what I mean? So
it's pretty funny that you bring that up because, you know, as you being a guest on the In or Out Sports Debate, we just had episode 76, and you know the By the Numbers segment that mm-hmm. I have. My topic was Steve McMichael he was the greatest of all time to wear 76. So yeah, yeah. For McMichael to be there, and I actually, in one of the graphics, I had one of his wrestling promo picks in there too, along with it, because it shows Bears, and then on his shorts, yep, on the bottom says 76. So I thought it was pretty funny that you brought that up at the same time. Now, with everything being said, and you know, you've been in this business for almost 23 years, 22-year veteran, starting in the year 2000. Take us back to the early days. I know this isn't quite like the year that you started, but you know, this is one of your earlier picks that I was able to find when I was researching. take us back to the early days, and what was it like taking those bumps in the beginning, and, you know, and some of the best advice that you got at the earlier on stages?
Well, you know, the thing is, we broke in the business kind of like Matt and Jeff Hardy and all them, because it wasn't exactly like it is today. Like, now there's a wrestling school on every corner, it seems like, you know. Back when we started, it wasn't as hard as it was in like the 70s and 80s and get involved, but it was still felt like you have to know somebody to know somebody that knows the secret handshake to get in the wrestling business. That's kind of the way that felt, you know. So we, as kids, you know, we caught up with a group that they built a ring, you know, and so we were kind of doing backyard stuff, you know, and Memphis Championship Wrestling was a developmental territory at the time for the WWF. And they were coming to our hometown, and every month they would come and they were drawing like 30, 40 people. And this is when they had William Regal, they had R-Truth, they had Daniel Bryan when he was still the American Dragon under the mask. They had, you know, the Mean Street Posse and, you know, Reckless Youth and just a ton of talent. I mean, the talent roster itself was amazing, but they were only drawing 30 or 40 people. So my friend, his dad was a police officer in our hometown, you know, so he went up to the promoter after one of the shows and was like, "Hey, listen, my son and his friends are trying to break in the wrestling business. Can you help them?" Right. So the guy said, yeah, we can help them, you know, have them come by next month, help us put up the ring and stuff like that. And we'll bump them around a little bit. And we'll probably put them like in an intermission match is what he called it. Right. I was like, okay. So we went around for the next month, you know, telling everybody, "Hey, we're professional wrestlers. You know, we're going to be wrestling, you know, we're going to be in this, blah, blah, blah." Right. So we get there that day and we help put everything up, and then we start bumping around, and dude, it hurts so bad. Like, I literally, this is the first time I'd ever bumped in an actual ring, you know, and like, it hurt so bad. Like, I didn't know what was going to happen, but they liked what we did. They felt like a lot of things they showed that, and they were like, "Okay, you guys can have your intermission match." Well, intermission match ended up being semi-main event. Right. And they didn't put us in the locker room with all the people I was telling you about. They put us in a different area completely by ourselves to protect the business. Right. So we were just in there by ourselves. The only person that came over to see us was the referee and Reckless Youth. Reckless Youth came over and thanked us for, you know, "Hey, thank you guys for getting in the business. Keep your heads up. Keep working, you know, blah, blah, blah." So I always thought a lot of Reckless Youth for doing that, because he was the only one that did. So we go, like I said, this is intermission match, and 200 people show up to this show. Because, like I said, we went around for the month before telling everybody what was going on. So 200 people ended up at the show. We go out, we do okay, but like, we had no clue about baby and heel and psychology, and we just had no clue about any of that kind of stuff. We were just imitating what we did on television, you know what I mean? Or what we saw on television. So like, it went okay, you know, better than expected, I guess. And after the matches, William Regal came up to me, and he's like, when you kick out, bloody kick out, you know what I mean? Because I was doing the Ric Flair 1-2, you know, I was doing that on pretty much every pin, I think. And he came out and called me out on it, but he wasn't mean about it. Because he was a kid too when he started, and he saw that in us, I guess, and was like just trying to help us get advice, you know. And we did that for a couple months. And then eventually Memphis Championship Wrestling lost their developmental deal and closed shop. And then we caught on with a local company. And that's really when we started working every week and training and doing all that kind of stuff.
Now, when MCW closed, when you were during that time with MCW, was that when you were trained by Bill Dundee and Tom Pritchard, or did that happen later on?
So here's the funny story about that. So so I worked the House of Hardcore show for Tommy Dreamer. And they had one in Nashville a couple of years ago. And Dreamer said he wanted me on it. You know, okay, cool. So, like, we made plans. And I get there the day of the show, and he goes, "Hey, I'm going to put you in this six-man tag, you know, against Jack Stain and Crimson and Dundee, six-man tag, you know, and your partners are these guys." And he was like, "Yeah, because, you know, Bill trained you." And I said, "No, Bill didn't train me." He said, "Bill Dundee didn't train you?" I said, no, Bill didn't train me. I said, "I went to a school a couple times when I was younger, but he didn't train me." And he goes, "Well, Bill said he trained you." So I was like, "Well, it's history now. We're going to put that on the resume."
So that's how it made it to Wikipedia.
That's how it made it to Wikipedia.
Yeah. So, that's awesome.
So, but yeah, that was fun. And then the Tom Pritchard thing was, I really credit him with a lot because I've been working for 2 years and we did a weekend camp with Dr. Tom. And that was one of the most eye-opening learning experiences that I had had. You know what I mean? Because he really, he liked the old school wrestling. Like I talk about, like the territory stuff and the walking and talking and not planning everything out bit by bit and stuff like that. And he really broke down a lot of different things to me. Like I tell my guys too, like, you know, give a man a fish, feed him for a day, teach a man a fish, feed him for a lifetime, right? Tom Pritchard teaches people how to fish. You know what I mean? He gives them that mindset of this is what wrestling is supposed to look like and feel like, and this is what it's supposed to be. You know what I mean? And what you come up creatively off of that is just based on that core idea, you know? And he kind of opened my mind to that kind of stuff. I was okay. And he was really cool with me too, because like he was a big fan of the Nightmares, the Ken Wayne and Danny Davis as the Nightmares, their tag team in Memphis and Continental and throughout the South. And he said I reminded him of Ken Wayne, you know, and that was one of his favorite workers. So, and we went out, me and a guy named Stan Lee went out the night he was there, and we just tore the house down with a great walk and talk match. Like, didn't talk about anything except the finish. Went out there and just worked and wrestled, and he really enjoyed it. And at that camp I got his number to Stanford because he was still the head of WWE talent at the time. So I got his number to Stanford, and I kept in contact with him, and, you know, I would send him matches, and he would just give me great feedback and like, you know, you're doing a great job. Just keep doing this, keep doing that. And then eventually he got moved out of that position, obviously. But he actually, one cool thing too was one time when I sent him one of my VHS tapes, I found an old magazine from like his rookie year with him, like a spotlight kind of thing with Tom Pritchard. You know what I mean? I found that magazine. So I sent that in with my tape. Right. So okay. When he got it, he popped, you know, he popped, and he was actually doing an article on WWE.com at the time. And in the article, he said, thanks for the memory, Golden Boy. That was the name of the article. And he wrote this whole article about his time period and what was going on then and thanked me for sending him the thing and said I was he crowned me the new Golden Boy because he said I used to wrestle Golden Boy so-and-so in this area and Golden Boy this and this is the new Golden Boy and that kind of thing. So that really helped.
And that was the birth of the Golden Boy.
Well, it wasn't the birth of him, but I mean, at least it was the rub in the right direction.
Well, that's a great story there. I mean, and you know, going from MCW and then, you know, you made your way into NWA Mid-South where you became the NWA Southern Junior Heavyweight Champion, you know, for years after that, you know, you racked up titles in Tennessee, Arkansas, and Missouri up to that point where you made that name happen, where you earned the name the Golden Boy. Tell us a little bit about that 10-year leading on up to teaming with this guy, Mr. Bobby Eaton.
Yes. And, you know, it was such a special thing because, like I said, I started in 2000 and me and Bobby started tagging in, I think, 2009. Right. So I was pretty polished, you know, when I got to be with Bobby. You know what I mean? And the reason that I... besides the fact that it was Bobby Eaton and I'd be a moron to turn down the opportunity to tag with him. I'd already done a lot of the single stuff. I had done junior heavyweight stuff and I'd done main event stuff and like heavyweight title stuff. And I really wanted to, okay, I need to sink my teeth into tag team wrestling to really learn that kind of stuff and make sure that I'm up to par, you know, on that side of the business. So when I started tagging with Bobby, and what I learned with Bobby was he just instilled a lot of confidence in me. Like, he called me the captain of Midnight Gold. And, like, I would put together all of our matches and things like that, and then I would present them, hey, this is present it to him of what we're going to do. And every once in a while, he'd have a question like, why are we doing this or why are we doing that? And I would explain my thought process behind it, and he'd go, okay, that makes sense, and we would do it. He never once said, no, we're not doing that. The only time he did stuff like that is when the promoters would come and they'd be like, okay, we're going to do this, 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 and we want to beat Greg. And then Bobby would chime in and go, we're not beating Greg. He said, we're beating me. The entire time me and Bobby Eaton tagged, he never let me take a pin. You know, and that's something that's huge for someone, you know, as young as I was, stuff like that. But, like, he believed in me and he thought that this Midnight Gold thing was his opportunity to give back to professional wrestling that had given him anything. Cause at the end of the day, Bobby Eaton was nothing more than a wrestling fan like all of us, you know, so he loved professional wrestling and he wanted to see it survive. So like that, I was in his last match. We had a 6-man tag and I was in his last match. And like, but he was not only was he one of the greatest in-ring performers of all time, but he's a better person. And that's saying a lot. You know what I mean? He would give you the shirt off his back, you know, even if he just met you. Actually, one of my favorite stories about Bobby is one of my buddies, Mark Rivera, who's from up near the D.C. area. He said that he was on a show with Bobby, and, like, he was fixing to go out for his match, and he was looking around. And Bobby goes, hey, what are you doing? And he goes, I'm looking for my T-shirt. I can't find it. So Bobby's kind of helping him look for the T-shirt for a second, right? And he goes, never mind. And he goes to the ring, does his match, 20 minutes, comes back, comes to the back. Bobby's still looking for his shirt. You know what I mean? It's like the little things like that. Like, people don't understand how good of a guy he really was. You know what I mean? There'd be times we'd be traveling with him and, you know, we'd stop at a gas station. We'd go and pee, get our stuff, come back to the car. Like, we'd wait about 10 minutes and, you know, where's Bobby? And then Bobby would come out with some random guy and he bought the guy like groceries or something. You know what I mean? It was just stuff like that.
I think that's a really cool part of that story where you hadn't even been in the business for a decade yet. And here you got this legend who everyone knows from, you know, his time on the bigger stage, who's letting you be the ring general when you're tagging up with him and calling the shots and then being a bigger person. It's like, it speaks volumes for his character to be the one that takes the pins and to propel you up and to help boost you up in your career. I really like that part of that story. Well,
And the fun thing too was, of course, this was the end of his career, and that's what I was there for. I was there to take some of that burden off of him. He still needed to get bookings. He still needed to make a living, you know. But obviously, at his age and what was going on health wise, he couldn't do everything that he needed to do. So that's why I was there. I was there to be that person. I was more than happy to be that person. But I'll tell you, every once in a while, you know what I mean, we would be in a match and I'd be with somebody that I knew for years and we had really good chemistry and we'd be going and I'd look at Bobby in the corner and he had that look in his eye like it was 1985 again. And I'd tag him in and he would start going. You know what I mean? And it's like, and it was just like me, kid in a candy store. I'm just sitting on the apron, like mouth open, like watching, because Bobby Eaton was one of my idols, you know, growing up.
That's a great story right there. And you guys carried that momentum into TCW, you know, and once he retired, this is another part of the story I think is really cool. You were the inaugural TCW World Junior Heavyweight Champion.
Yeah.
And, you know, became a 3-time International Heavyweight Champion as well. And also 2-time tag champion with the one you mentioned with Matt Rivera. And with that being said, like, what are some of your greatest memories at being a champion within that and helping, you know, boost his company and TCW up to what it was?
TCW was, you know, like I said, with the Bobby Eaton stuff, that was the first time that people really started talking about me, right? And like at first, TCW, Matt wanted to bring in, he wanted to bring in Midnight Express. He wanted to bring in Bobby and Dennis or Bobby and Stan. He wanted to bring in some variation of that. He didn't know me, you know what I mean? So, and this is why I tell guys, you never know where opportunity is going to come, so always be prepared, right? So I do some bullshit show in Arkansas that has 12 people at it. I swear to you. The promoter does the whole thing, comes to the bank and goes, hey, guys, listen, there's only 12 people out there. If you want to wrestle, you can wrestle, but I can't pay anybody, blah, 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 right? So I'm like, well, this was like 3 hours away from me, I think, or something like that. I was like, well, I'm already here, and I want to wrestle anyway, so I'll wrestle, right? So I go on first with this kid that the promoter had trained, right? Go out there, have a really, really good, solid match with this kid, like really, really good. And I get to the back, and Riviera's there. So Riviera goes, wow, that's a good match. How long have you been training the kid? I said, well, he's not my kid. He's so-and-so's kid. I just met him today. He said, that's not your trainee, and you walked out there not knowing him and had that kind of match with him? And I said, yeah. And he just kind of shook his head. And then after that, he booked me on everything he ever did from there on out. You know what I mean? Because I decided to work a bullshit show in Arkansas in front of 12 people, I ended up on a television program that was available to 50 million.
Wow.
You know what I mean? And that's, I tell guys all the time, like, you know, everyone's, well, I'm not leaving my house unless I get X amount of dollars. That is the absolute wrong attitude to have if you have nothing to offer. You understand? Like, if you're just a guy trying to learn and you haven't proven to anybody what your worth is yet, and you're trying to tell me you're not leaving your house, then sit at home.
Absolutely.
You know, I've wrestled close to 4,000 matches. And I don't think I've ever turned down. You know what I mean? So, mm-hmm. I mean, it's all about that work. You have to get in there. The only way to learn how to wrestle sometimes is to wrestle.
And with some of the things, you know, and I'm in a different category, but there's certain things in my life professionally that I've had opportunities with based on what somebody else saw me do in another atmosphere, and just knowing what I bring to that, I've gotten opportunities based on that too. And other people have had other successful stories with that as well. So just with you being able to say you did some small show to help you get to a bigger stage, that's a big lesson to everybody out here. It's not the amount of people that are watching. It's who's watching, because it only takes one important person to notice your work to propel you to another stage.
Yeah, and the great thing about TCW, too, was Matt was such an old school fan that he did not want to change me at all. You understand? Like, he looked at me like, you know, like what I had, and I was, you know me, I've never been, you know, in bodybuilder shape. I've never been in WWE shape, as they say. But he was a promoter that was in, like I said, we were in 50 million homes, and he would let me be me. He's like, I would be like, do you want me to get in better shape or something like that? Like, no, what you're doing right now is perfect. You know what I mean? Because he liked the old school junior heavyweight, you know, kind of, you know, mentality. Our whole thing was, my whole basis for the junior heavyweight title at the time was when Luthez and Danny Hodge were world heavyweight champion and world junior heavyweight champion, they weren't, you know, Danny wasn't less than Lou because he was a junior heavyweight. No, they were both world heavyweight champions. They were both champions, and they were on the same kilter. So, like, that was my thought process with the junior title. Just because I'm a junior heavyweight doesn't mean I'm less of a wrestler than this guy. It just means I weigh less. You know what I mean? That kind of thing. So, like, that was kind of the approach we took. And even the first time I won the title, I won it with an Oklahoma roll for Danny Hodge. You know,
which when you see bigger promotions, like back in the day, like when we were talking about the Attitude Era a little bit earlier, and you see cruiserweight and light heavyweight, mm-hmm. they didn't really display that like you were just talking about with the promotions that you've been a part of. They kind of made it seem like they were lesser than, and yeah. to hear other promotions like not treat these other, like the junior heavyweights, any different than they did the heavyweight, that's another cool part of that story as well.
Yeah, absolutely.
So now when you, before we get into the further part of your career, like throughout this journey, you've been to conventions, you know, you've met some like legends throughout the entertainment aspect of wrestling and every part of it as well. If you were to think of one particular person out of everyone that you've met, who would that be that gave you some of the best sound advice in those moments as far as your wrestling career goes?
Let me think for a second. I mean, like I said, there's so many guys. I mean, a guy like, I don't know if that helps or not. I don't know. I just, you know, the old school guys are a little, I want to say they're a little less likely to just randomly give you advice. You know what I mean? Like, they want you to kind of earn it, and you kind of got to get to know them a little first, though. But I mean, like Kevin Sullivan, for instance, I wrestled the Tokyo Monster Cahagas in Vegas, and Kevin Sullivan was his manager for the match, right? And I met Kevin a couple times, but he'd never seen me wrestle for sure, right? So we go out there, we have a really good match, we get to the back, and you know, I kind of walk up and say, you know, thank you to Cahagas. And Kevin Sullivan goes, "You can work your ass off." So I think I like getting rubs like that. You know what I mean? Because I think they see that old school stuff in me that they, you know, they did, and they understand what we're trying to do. So guys like that, you know, when I met Lance Russell, he was, you know, he was super nice and super sweet. And him being, you know, a Memphis wrestling legend like that, it was fun to see him. You know, it's just and like I said, Dr. Tom, just because he gave me that basis for a lot of that kind of stuff, you know?
So like pretty much like rubs and stuff like that. You really haven't met anybody like, you know, with going through and seeing the pictures, like you've met Pat Patterson, AJ Styles, Edge, Mickey James, all these different people that are like, you know, have gotten to the bigger stage. There's none of them that were able to be able to give you some type of sound advice to help you out throughout your journey, or just meeting, meet and greets.
Well, no, what happens is, here's the thing too, especially guys that have been wrestling for a long time at a high level. A lot of times the last thing they want to talk about is wrestling. Unfortunately, like I'm the opposite. I love talking about wrestling. I'll sit here and talk 3 hours about wrestling. But some guys, like when I met AJ, he was talking about football. You know what I mean? Like, you know, it's just like that. Sometimes they don't want to talk about wrestling. They want to talk about anything but, you know what I mean?
Okay.
And like, so it's hard to get them kind of in that mode. And they're not going to watch your match either a lot of times because they're busy getting their stuff together, you know? So they're not going to really take an opportunity. You know, we try to ask them sometimes to do that kind of stuff, but it doesn't happen too often, you know? So you just kind of go with it. You know, you have an interaction with them. Maybe they see something they like, maybe they don't, whatever it is. But I mean, it is what it is, I guess.
I mean, I can understand that. You know, I've experienced that in different aspects, you know, outside of the wrestling stuff, that sometimes when they punch out, they just don't want to talk about what they do. They just want to, you know, talk about everything but. So I definitely understand where you're coming from with that. So going from TCW and, you know, with your work with the National Wrestling Alliance and, you know, in how it shifted into pro wrestling Mid-South, tell everyone about your career within that and what are some of your biggest highlights you could take away from that?
Well, you know, the NWA, actually, when we stopped working for Memphis Championship Wrestling, when they lost their developmental and we caught on with the local company we caught on with was WOWF, it was Warriors of Wrestling Federation, but it was actually Warriors of Wrestling Federation / NWA Mid-South. Right. And it was Alvin Minnick owned the NWA Mid-South part of that. Right. So, and he's the one that, that made me the first, when I won my first, Southern Junior Heavyweight title, you know, and like, he was the one, he was actually in charge of the World Junior Heavyweight title, within the NWA. And he would do all the rankings on the website and things like that. And the, like, he had made me like ranked above Jushin Thunder Liger at one point, you know, when I'd only been wrestling like 3 years, but, so like I have a long history off and on because that's why we went when we decided we were going to be NWA in 2014. You know, we decided we're going to be NWA Mid-South because I wanted to continue his history. Like if you look at our title history, I think it goes back to like 1998. You know, and then this revamp started, like I said, it started in 2014. So like it was just a continuation of everything. You know, kind of full circle for me because, like, it was kind of is where I really started, you know, working like that on a weekly basis, you know, and getting that polish.
That's definitely pretty sweet. So it's not like what was it, NWA Power, which they've got on YouTube. It's a different association. It has nothing to do with that.
Well, technically it's the same companies, but I mean, like, so the National Wrestling Alliance used to be an alliance of promotions throughout the world, country, whatever, how you want to say it. Now it's just one guy. So there's not really an alliance to it. You know, it's just Billy Corgan, much like Tony Khan, playing with his wrestling figures. You know, so I really don't like the new NWA product because I think that they're what I like to call faux old school. You know what I mean? Like they have the ring ropes, they have the arena, it looks like this, it looks like that, but then the bell rings and they're doing the same shit every other federation's doing. So, like, to me, it's not the same. The only thing I liked about it was when Trevor Murdoch was the World's Heavyweight Champion because I had pitched for Trevor Murdoch to be the World's Heavyweight Champion 5-6 years before that, you know, and no one listened to me. I was like, that's the guy that needs to be the champion, you know, because he's the epitome of that old school kind of thing, you know, and, like, it was great to see him, and I think he did really well with it, and he hasn't gotten the respect or the run that he deserves with that title either. He's like a 2-time champion, but he's only been champion. I think he was only champion for like 2 months the first time and maybe like 3 months the second time or something. It was something ridiculous. But I mean, it's just, he's the kind of guy that, you know, that company should be built around.
Now there's something that you had touched up on earlier talking about, you didn't have the WWE body, but you're still able to pull off moves like this. Like, you're still able to do, you know, high risk maneuvers and stuff. Tell us a little bit about your skill set, and especially the Midas touch.
Well, let me preface this by saying, like, so you remember Susan Boyle? You don't remember Susan Boyle? She mm-hmm. was the woman that came out on, I think it was America's Got Talent. And, like, she was real frumpy, and she was older, and her hair was all wild. And she comes out, and you're like, oh, this is going to be disastrous. You know, this is going to be horrible, right? And she opens her mouth and starts to sing, and she ends up being, like an amazing opera singer. You know what I mean? And, like, the entire panel just, like, freaked out. And I think she ended up making it to the finals that year and almost winning. Right. Okay. So I've always kind of likened myself to like Susan Boyle. Like when I come out, no one's ever seen me before. No one's ever heard of me. If I come out on a show and they see me the way I look and stuff like that, they go, who the hell is this guy? You know what I mean, what is this is a professional. What is going on here? And then all of a sudden I start talking and I start wrestling. And I start doing my thing. And all of a sudden they're like, oh, okay, he's good. You know, it's almost like a shock factor that they didn't think I was going to be good. And then I am. So, like, that's always kind of worked in my favor. And, like, a part of it was, too, like, I was always on shows with guys that were in shape. So, like, I felt if I got in shape, too, then I wouldn't stand out. Like, I would just look like everyone else, you know? So, like, I didn't feel the need to do that. So, like, I liked being different. I liked being that, you know, that different thing at the buffet, you know what I mean? I guess you could say, you know? But another point to this that we didn't know at the time. So, like, when you want opportunities and things like that, and another company will say to you, they'll use a phrase that's called, you need to get bigger. And what by you need to get bigger means is you need to get on steroids. That's the lingo of it. Mm-hmm. So you know, I've heard that a couple times over the years. But, like, the thing about it is I end up having I have a genetic heart condition. I have no right arteries. I just have left, right? And if I would have succumbed to that peer pressure and got on steroids like they wanted me to, it would have been disastrous. I mean, what I have already should have killed me in my 20s. But because I played basketball through school and because I started wrestling when I was 18, they said that I had built my heart up so much that I was basically my heart was compensating for what it lacked, basically. But if I would have got on steroids, there ain't no telling what kind of blockages I would have had, you know, from that. So it's almost God works in mysterious ways. You know what I mean? And, like, this is a prime example. Like, he gave me a passion for professional wrestling, you know, and everything in my life has kind of led up to that. And, like, wrestling has saved my life in that sense, you know?
And had you actually gone with the get bigger message, you probably wouldn't be breathing right now. No, you know, with everything being said, like, you wouldn't even be here.
Well, even the thing, too, is, like, you know, I was originally born in Southern Illinois. And, like, I tell everybody, like, Southern Illinois, there's wrestling federations, but they're not as prominent as they are here. Like, here in West Tennessee, I can't throw a rock without hitting a weekly wrestling promotion. You know what I mean? So, like, not only did, you know, God give me, you know, my grandmother who had this passion for wrestling, then I had a passion for wrestling. He moved my entire family from Southern Illinois to West Tennessee. We got transferred with a company. You know, we got transferred to West Tennessee, and all of a sudden I'm in, you know, one of the most hotbed places of professional wrestling that always has, like I said, there's always a week. It was almost impossible for me with a passion for professional wrestling not to become a wrestler because I was here. You know what I mean? Like, it's just weird how the world works. And when the doctors basically told me, like, yeah, if you wouldn't play basketball and if you wouldn't wrestle, what you have should have killed you in your 20s.
Absolutely. You know?
So wrestling to absolutely 100%. God and wrestling saved my life. So.
And on the back end of that original question, before you answer that, I want to take a slight break and take a look at one of Greg's videos before I ask him that question one more again.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the KAYFABE Express. We are here with the golden boy, Greg Anthony. Now, looking at those highlights there in that video, I'm telling you, and I've told you before, on air, off air, and I'll say it again, that is one of the most unique finishers I've ever seen with the Midas touch. Where did you come up with that? It's like an inadvertent stunner in a way. Like, where did you come up with that?
Yeah, yeah. Like, my buddy John Michael, he's a highly creative person too. You know, he actually invented the soul food. You know what I'm talking about? Where you put the foot under the guy's chin and take the back bump.
Mm-mm. I never heard that before, but that sounds pretty cool.
Yeah, you had to have seen it. Everyone.
I mean, I probably seen it. I just didn't know what it was called.
Yeah, yeah. They twist the guy's arm and then put their foot under the guy's chin. They take a bump and the guy. Anyway, it's called the soul food. Chuck Taylor used to do it. Gail Kim did it as a finish. Like that. Well, my buddy John Michael actually invented it here. You know, and basically what happened was he invented it, and he was letting someone else here use it. But then when he wrestled in Nashville, John Michael was using it, right? And when John Michael was using it, Chuck Taylor was on the same cards with him, right? So Chuck Taylor then started doing it. And then when Chuck Taylor started doing it, then all of a sudden it made the independent rounds, you know what I mean? And now it's in video games and stuff like that.
So, yeah, now that you say that, I do remember seeing it.
Yeah, yeah. So John Michael actually came up with something. William Regal used to do the thing where he twist the guy around and give him the neck breaker with his arm. You know what I mean? So mm-hmm. John Michael came up with a version of that was a cutter, you know, like an RKO, but with the arm trapped like that. And, you know, he didn't really use it that much. And like, I was looking for something newer to use as a finish and things like that. And like, my favorite finisher of all time is the Stone Cold Stunner or the Sweet Chin Music, but Stone Cold Stunner mainly. So I decided I would use it as a stunner. So I twist and grit the arm and there's a stunner. So.
Now that's, I just, everybody who saw your first episode, you know, especially the ones at our network was like, what is that? I was like, that's his finishing move, guys. I was like, it's the Midas touch. Like, you know, it's like an inadvertent stunner. And they're like, I like that. Like pro wrestling fans on our network, that's like one of their favorite finishers. Now I just wanted to share that with you, that thing that is very creative. And to know the background of where that came from, it's got an awesome story with that behind it as well.
Yeah. I mean, finisher. And the thing is too, like, you know, in our company, you know, there's only been two people in 7 years to kick out of the Midas touch, you know.
Really?
We protect everyone's finishes in my company, because if you don't, then they're not really finishes, are they? Mm. Right? And that seems to be the, you know, we have that problem all over professional wrestling now. Is it's not one spear, it's three spears. It's two Superman punches and three spears is his finish. It's not one spear anymore. You know what I mean? Stuff like that. So, like, we always protect everyone's finish, though. And that's the thing. Everyone and anybody that's anybody, you know, that's come to our shows, they know that's my finish. Like, that's it. Boom. 1, 2, 3. You know? So.
The one thing that was interesting about, you know, preparing for this episode, I didn't know that you had worked with this guy right here, with Hacksaw Jim Duggan. What was that like working with him for a little bit?
Yeah, see, Hacksaw was a Matt Riviera used him quite a bit in TCW because that was the old Mid-South territory. So, like, Matt used him quite a bit. So I knew him from that, you know, and we never actually wrestled each other or tagged because I was heel and he was baby and we never really worked each other. He was always working with the Sheik or someone like that, you know. But, like, always a great guy, you know, always, you know, fun to be around. And, you know, just had an opportunity to where we were going to – we had a big show in Cleveland, Tennessee, and asked him to be a part of it. We ended up winning the Legends and Lions tag titles. So that was pretty cool. You know, like, I've been tag champs with Beautiful Bobby Eaton. I've tagged with Jerry Lawler and, you know, tag titles with Hacksaw Jim Duggan. Like, if you told 9-year-old me all that, you know, my head would probably explode.
Now, there's another picture. And I kind of brought it up earlier. Tell us about the background of this iconic picture right here with the blood and the championship and what transpired in that.
So, I had been in a feud with a guy named Bull Bronson, and Bull Bronson is 6'4", 450 pounds. And, he's a tough customer. And, he came and, you know, he he took my title away from me for a while, and like I fought and clawed to try to get it back, and I finally got a match with him, and you know, I end up winning the title back, you know, and obviously it, you know, I didn't leave unscathed. You know, Crimson Mask, as they say, or Crimson Half Mask, I guess, in this case. But yeah, it's one of those things, and I, you know, I, someone did that for me, by the way, the picture, because I don't know how to do that.
Really? Okay.
I'm okay at picture stuff, but like that's a little bit above my skill level.
Hey, if one thing I can at least give you some advice on, if you haven't checked it out yet, the app called Canva. That's what I use to make the graphics here, which when we first started the stuff with the In or Out Sports Debate, I wasn't even working with that yet. So this is something totally different that I can tell you about off camera, but it does wonders for making graphics, special effects, and we could definitely dive into that off air. But that's one thing just to throw you a little bit of advice with that. That's one of my favorite tools to use with that. Now, when it comes to community work and doing the things that you know, professional wrestlers like to do to get out there in the community, tell us a little bit about this picture right here.
Yeah, so one of the little kids there, he would come to my shows quite regular because his mom had actually died in a car accident.
I know
his aunt, who me and her went to school together. And when they were coming to the show, it had been like a week or so after his mom had passed, and he was coming to the show. So they kind of told me what was going on. He was coming to the show. So that night I pulled him in the ring, and I gave him a signed poster, and we did the strut together, and, you know, we did all this kind of stuff for him. And they said it really uplifted him, and really, and they started coming more often and stuff like that. And then I made arrangements to come to his class and see him, you know, with all the other kids. And it was a big event. I was picking kids up in suplexes and, you know, putting them down and just, you know, doing wrestling stuff. And like, it was a big time. I'm a big fan, obviously, I love my community. I love Dyersburg, Tennessee. I've raised my family here, obviously. And, you know, I just love being a part of the community. And like, you know, I think wrestling in this area did not have a very good reputation. Like when I started, for instance, there was a lot of drugs and alcohol and pedophilia and a lot of stuff that should not be going on in our business. So I made an effort when we started our company, hey, we're going to clean all that. And I think we've done a pretty good job of cleaning up that and telling people, at least they know the difference between Pro Wrestling Mid-South and our standard for what we do morally. You know, we're a family friendly organization, no cussing, nothing vulgar. We're also a Christian organization. You know what I mean? We actually hold worship services at my building on Sundays.
Oh, you nice.
Know, so like we want to be a part of the community. We want to make things a better place for everybody, especially for the kids.
Now, with everything you just said, you know, with where you're at in Dyersburg, Tennessee, pandemic comes 2020. How badly did that affect business? Like how long were you shut down due to that?
They shut us down for 5 months. It was a huge ordeal. 5 months we were shut down. You know, I have two buildings. We do Ripley's on Friday nights and we do Dyersburg on Saturday nights. So I had two buildings that I'm still paying for with nothing coming in. You know what I mean? It was a very, very difficult time. Everyone, you know, the local government, you know, their hands were kind of tied on everything because they were trying to follow state rules and things like that. We end up actually being the last business that they allowed to open.
Wow.
Because of the way some of the laws read here in Tennessee, one of the laws that said no close contact sports. And when they put that in, like I talked to the governor's office, I talked to a bunch of people. When they put that in, they were basically saying like amateur wrestling, you know, like school wrestling, you know, the kind of thing, which we don't have here anyway. But like, you know, they were talking about that, but somehow we got lumped into that. So like they wouldn't let us open at all. So like,
you don't have amateur wrestling in your area of Tennessee at all? Mm-hmm. Wow.
Yeah, like if we had amateur wrestling, obviously I would have been a part of that growing up, but like it's not big here at all. We actually had a guy, I don't even remember his name, but I know he opened a sports shop in Covington, which is only about 30, 40 minutes away from here. And he was like, I don't know if he was on the Olympic team or he was like an alternate or whatever the deal was, but like he came down here because he thought this would be basically like a virgin territory that he could upstart amateur wrestling and kind of make it like it is. You know, he told me he couldn't get anybody to buy it. He said, you know, he said he's from Pennsylvania and it's, you know, packed high school gyms for this stuff, you know, and he said here that no one cares. So like he packed up and moved back, I think. So
that's wild because it's big here in Virginia. Like, you know, when I was growing up, I was participating in amateur wrestling and, you know, it took me a while to actually get into professional wrestling because they kept telling you, don't watch that because it's going to mess with you when you're on here on the mat. Because I was starting when I was 6 years old as an amateur wrestler or whatnot.
Right.
It took me a little bit of time before I finally got into it. But that's unique. I didn't even know that. You thinking about how big pro wrestling is in Tennessee, you would think the amateur wrestling is there too.
Yeah, well, not in our area at least. Like, I think there's some in Jackson and maybe in Memphis, but like, in my area, West Tennessee, Dyersburg, Ripley, like all these kind of smaller schools, there's no wrestling team whatsoever. It's football, basketball, baseball, you know, and that's about it. And then maybe some golf and stuff like that, but no wrestling.
So with there was several business owners, at least, you know, throughout the country that during the pandemic, they were getting some type of stipend from the government to kind of help them out. Were they able to help you out with that in any type of way? Or were you just kind of basically paying out of pocket for 5 months until you could get back up and running?
Yeah, I was having to pay out of pocket because the way that it was explained to me was like, where do I fall? Right? Like, what is professional? Like, there's, you know, they need a subcategory of some kind to put me in to give me money. And like, they couldn't find what category it was. Am I a sport or am I in entertainment? Am I, you know, a gym, you know, type situation, or am I the, you know, they just couldn't figure out where to put me to get me approved, you know? So like, I never got anything like that at all. The only thing we got was our normal stimulus kind of stuff that was coming through. So
that's wild. Yeah, because I had another professional wrestler on the InterHouse Sports Debate in this local area who said that if it wasn't for his background in dentistry that he works, you know, outside of this, he wouldn't have made it because it was that rough. And he's just, a wrestler. You actually are a booker and in a trainer and all that stuff. So all that ties into different avenues into what you're doing. So you rely a lot more on that money coming in as someone who's running a business. That's a huge blow during that time frame. I can't imagine how rough it was during that 5 month tenure.
Yeah, it was bad. I mean, it was just like, you know, I took up magnet fishing. Like I don't even like being outside. You know what I mean? Like, most of the things that I like to do are indoors. And for some reason, I was so bored out of my mind. I couldn't do anything with wrestling, you know? So like I took up magnet fishing and then that didn't go well because there's nothing really in the little rivers and lakes here. I think I found some barbed wire and like a butter knife or something like that. I mean, it was just, but people were like, why are you still banging a fish? I was like, no. I haven't touched that in, you know, 3 years now or whatever it's been. So it's like, it was just a rough time. Like it was just, it was a hard thing to deal with. Like I said, you know, when I had my first heart surgery, I was out 4 months and, this past year, you know, I had a scan come back that they thought I might have another blockage. So I took another 2 months off until we got that figured out, which ended up being a miracle.
I remember
they told me I had a 70% blockage in one of my main arteries and we scheduled a heart cath. I fought for a month to make sure I got into the right hospital, Vanderbilt. We went in there, the guys get in there and then it's disappeared. Like there's no blockage whatsoever. And then everything they had said, like even the stenosis in my vein that was supposed to be there was like perfect. Like they were like, no, your vein looks fine. And like all your stents are great. Like we don't know what happened. You know, that kind of thing. So it was a 100% miracle on that thing. But I took off 2 months for that. So like 4 months for a heart surgery, 2 months for a scare, but then 5 months for pandemic.
Spent more time in the pandemic than you did for actual heart surgery. That's immaculate right there.
Yeah.
That was something I was actually going to touch up into next that we hadn't really dived into yet. Cause you're talking about, you know, being born and growing up with the heart issue you didn't really know about. Until, you know, as you were so active with everything, you know, how difficult was it to get the ring rust out after not just the 4 months, you know, 5 months of pandemic? I feel like maybe a little bit different ring rust wise than coming back from a major surgery.
I personally didn't have any ring rust. Like I came back and it was like riding a bike and it was
really?
It was such a weight off my shoulders to get to wrestle again. Cause you know, wrestling's been my entire life, since my entire adult life. You know what I mean? I've wrestled more years now than years that I didn't wrestle. You know what I mean? So, like, it's just a huge part of my life, and I've never taken any significant time off besides the ones we just discussed. You know what I mean? I've been wrestling week in, week out for 23 years almost. So, like, for me, like, after that 4 months, I was just so – I was chomping at the bit to get back in. And once I did, I had an amazing match, knocked it out of the park. I still get goosebumps to this day. You know, when I get to see it, it's like, you know, it's just one of those things that, like, it's always going to stay with me. It was just that, and that I did that match when I came back. And then 2 years after that, 2 years after that, I did a 60-minute Ironman match. And, like, that was a big thing for me too, because here I am 2 years out of heart surgery, you know, and I go 60 minutes, you know. Wow. So that was a big deal for, I was actually kind of emotional at the final bell, because I was like, I fucking did it, you know.
Now, with all that being said, did you have any type of reservations or anything going into that first match coming back from heart surgery? Or, like you said, it was just like riding a bike, but what did you have any thoughts going into it, that where it may not be that easy, or what was the preparation like leading into that?
I mean, I felt good. Like, I had what they call cardiac therapy, you know? So, like, I was going to, you know, basically it's like physical therapy for your heart, you know? And I was going to that, and I was demolishing every record that they had. Of course, I was 36 years old versus most of their patients are in their 70s and 80s or whatever. But, like, you know, I demolished it. So I felt good and stuff like that. You know, it's just one of those things, like, you know, the doctors are telling you basically, like, listen, you have a heart condition. You're probably going to get more blockages. You know, my doctor was basically telling me I was going to have open heart surgery before I was 40. And, like, so that weighed on my mind, you know, quite a bit. You know, like, I didn't know what was going to happen from day to day, but, like, you know, eventually it got better. And eventually, you know, like, you know, once I've, you know, delved more into my Christianity and start praying and things like that, a lot of that stuff really started coming off. And I started having a better outlook on that kind of stuff. So a lot of that stuff doesn't even cross my mind now. Like, sometimes, like, I don't take chops anymore because I don't want to chance. You know what I mean? Like, I think it's just a mental block kind of thing for me. Like, I don't think that they're going to put me in cardiac arrest or anything like that, but I don't know if I want to take the chance, you know, considering all that I have done, you know. And then we see the guy from the Buffalo Bills, you know, last few weeks, he had cardiac arrest from getting hit in the chest like that. And it's just like, maybe not, you know? So, but other than that, you know, I really don't have any reservations. I wrestle, you know, 30, 40 minutes a night most of the time anyway, you know what I mean? I'm out there going, so. And I'm 40, like, so I'm going to be 42 in June. So,
and with you being a family man, and especially with the scare, with the health scare with that, you know, your wife and kids didn't try to talk you out of going back into it, just say, hey, just be a booker and a trainer and kind of hang up your boots. Kind of like how with what happened with Triple H and WWE, was there any type of talk like that going on with that during that time or what?
My mom, of course, at before the first heart surgery, she had kind of hinted around, like, why don't you just do this? And my uncle too. My uncle's really never really, he doesn't really like the fact that I wrestle. They always thought I should, because of my personality and things like that, they thought I could have made $1 million as a salesman or, you know, done something other than this. And, like, for me, it's like, yeah, but I don't like any of that shit. You know what I mean? Like, I tell people all the time, I would rather make $10,000 wrestling than I would $100,000 doing anything else. You understand? Because especially now, after I understand how short life is and how quickly it can end in the blink of an eye, you know, I don't want to spend any wasted time doing something that I don't want to do. That's why I've found a way to make a living in professional wrestling. Is it, you know, am I a millionaire? No, but, you know, I've got a roof over my head. I got food on my table, and, you know, my family's taken care of. Mm-hmm. So, like, it's just all about that kind of balance. So, no, there really wasn't much of a conversation of it, because I'm pretty strong-willed when it comes to that anyway. Like, wrestling was the first thing I did that my family didn't want me to do, and I did anyway. Right? Because, like, you know, they were like, when I first started, like, I was going to break into it, they're like, I don't know, you shouldn't do that. And I was like, oh, fuck it, I'm doing it. You know, and I just did it on my own, you know, and that was the first time, as you know, that I did something I took responsibility for it myself and did it on my own. And I just have never looked back, you know? So no, not too much.
So, you know, now that we've kind of, you know, started from the beginning, worked our way on up to the present, where do you see yourself as far as your wrestling career going from here? Do you see yourself still wrestling in 5 years from now? Or do you think that it's getting towards the time where you start shifting into that more of a trainer and booker mentality and less into the performance aspect of it?
My immediate goal is 50 years old. So I want to wrestle as much as I can. And maybe, like I said, to 50 years old. Once I get there, then maybe I'll pull back some, wrestle, you know, be more of a part-time kind of thing as far as in-ring matches go. But, you know, like I tell everybody, my mom has said, since I'm like, why don't you just book? Why don't you just train? Why don't you just do this? And like, I was like, listen, you know, I can do that if I was in a wheelchair. You know what I mean? Like, I can only do this. You know, there's only a finite amount of time. You know, you can do this. Everyone, I'm sure you've heard the phrase, everyone's got a bump card. Mm-hmm. You know, and eventually you take your last bump. You probably don't even know it's going to be your last bump, but you're going to take it. you know what I mean? And I don't know where my bump card is, but like, I feel good. Like I said, I'm 41 now, close to 4,000 matches, and I'm still going strong and I feel pretty good, you know? So I'm hoping for 50, you know what I mean? So like, we'll just have to play everything out of here, but that's me in my mind. That's my immediate goal.
Hey, if Jerry Lawler and, of course, Ric Flair can keep wrestling, you know, and with what they've done and what's going on with them, that I feel like you can make it to 50.
Yeah, and that's the thing, too. Like, I love wrestling so much that, and I think I'm smart enough about it that I can do well. It's just I don't want to be embarrassing, obviously. I don't want to ever get to that point. But at the same time, like, I feel like I can put myself in certain situations where it could still be worthwhile. You know what I mean? That I can still contribute. Cause the hardest thing to do when teaching someone professional wrestling business, I can tell them all day long how it's supposed to go and give them all these theories and do this stuff. But until they're in a match and they feel how it works, you know what I mean? Like, and they can understand that, you know, it's a much different thing. So it's hands-on training a lot of times with my kids. I told them all the time, like, my legacy in professional wrestling isn't going to be three-time NWA National Heavyweight Champion or all the kind of stuff like that. It's going to be the guys that I train that are going to take this thought process that is almost extinct nowadays with professional wrestling, take this thought process we've taught them, and then they teach the next generation of guys and then the next generation guys, and maybe what we're talking about here all still exists in 30 years. You know what I mean? So like that's my big hope is that like the way that we do business, the way that I know the business should be presented, still has a home somewhere in professional wrestling, and especially in West Tennessee.
Outside of your kids that you train, you know, at work, you know, and with both you and Xander have been on the Inner Out Sports Debate. Xander and I talked about this a little bit. You know, his love is basketball. You guys love basketball and football and, of course, the 49ers. I'm not even going to touch into that because of everything that just happened this past weekend. I'm going to be nice to you today. But, you know, Xander, big with basketball. Now, have either one of your sons expressed any interest in following in your footsteps in professional wrestling?
Well, my oldest son is wrestling.
Oh, he is.
He's 15, and we started training him. He was just fixing to turn 14. I usually wait till the kids are 15 to start training them, but these were my own kids, and like my oldest son, he was actually like 5'8" and 230 pounds when I decided to start training him. So I was like, well, he's big enough for sure, you know. So we started doing that, and he dropped a bunch of weight, and but yeah, he's doing really well. He's been wrestling for about 10 months now.
Okay.
And he does really well. And Xander, you know, we're, you know, the plan is to start him, you know, probably in the summer, start training him. So, I mean, and it usually takes me about 6 months to a year to train somebody, get a match ready. So we'll just have to see where it goes.
You see yourself doing like a 6-man tag with both your sons one day before you hang them up?
Yeah, that would be the dream. You know what I mean? Like we've talked about it for years, you know, that kind of thing. Like I think a couple of years ago I took Xavier to a show. I was doing some show in Mississippi and I took him with me because I did a seminar and I used him for the seminar stuff or as a, you know, just an extra body in the seminar. And like I had said, you know, I don't know if they'll ever get in wrestling. I don't know if they'll ever want to get in wrestling, but you know, it would be a dream of mine to tag or six man or something like that. So maybe one day that'll happen. Like I said, if I wrestle till I'm 50, you know, I mean, we have plenty of time now. So
I hope it happens for you, man. Just from working with Xander on those two episodes, kid's something else. He's got an awesome personality. And those highlight videos that you were sharing, especially that game winning shot it looked like that he made or whatnot a while back or whatnot, he's talented. Just from what I've seen a little bit from him, you guys got a bright future ahead of you. And you know, your kids are going to carry on your legacy in one way or another, whether it's inside the ring or outside the ring. The Golden Boy moniker is going to live on.
Let me brag on Xander for a second. He plays for the middle school team, but I coach at the activity center here in town. He's on my activity center team, right? Mm-hmm. The other day, he had 37 points, 12 rebounds, like 8 assists, 4 blocks and 2 steals or something like that. He's dominating this league like ridiculously. So,
hey man, you might see him make the Bulls team one day or something. Get drafted by the Bulls, that'd be pretty sweet. And yeah, then you know, then do some Dennis Rodman kind of stuff. Not like as far out as Dennis Rodman was, but come and help you out, you know, and be a part of your promotion on the off season. You never know.
Right. Yeah. So I don't think the NBA contract would allow that. Literally let those guys like drive motorcycles. Yeah, I don't think they're going to let me pile drive somebody.
Yep. Especially after what happened with Ben Roethlisberger, you know, in the 2000s when he had that motorcycle accident, you know, fresh off that Super Bowl.
There was a Bulls player too. I don't even remember his name. It was in the early 2000s too, but he had a motorcycle wreck and basically blew out his knee and was never the same.
I can see his face because I know exactly who you're talking about, but I cannot think of his name. Yeah, I can't think of his face.
Like a J, starts with a J or a B or something.
Mm-hmm. That's going to bother me now that we don't. I'm going to figure it out. Now I'm going to message you later and be like, this is who it was.
This is who it was.
Yeah. but no, man, I'm really happy for you. I'm guessing that it's because the missus doesn't know about the training or whatnot going on.
Oh no, something like that. It's just he wrestles under a mask.
Oh, okay.
So
okay.
he's not, you know, presented as my child. So I mean,
okay. Yeah, so that's an awesome way to do that too. It's kind of like shield him away from, you know, getting the pressures of what you, to live up to you at this point. I mean, he's still a teenager. Like he's still got plenty of time to kind of embrace that. You know, as we've seen with like other ones who've lived up to the legacies, like, you know, like Cody Rhodes, he kind of shielded away from it for a while. But then as he kind of got older, then he started to embrace it because that's part of who he is. And that I definitely understand where you're coming from with that. And I really appreciate you taking the time today to be here and talk about your career and talk about a little bit more than that, especially with everything we've all lived through one way or another, no matter what profession we are in. We were all kind of brought together by the pandemic, so we kind of understand what everybody was going through. And for you to share, you know, your insight on everything that you've experienced in the last 22 years of professional wrestling and what led you up to that, I can't thank you enough for taking the time to be here today with me to discuss that stuff.
Absolutely, man. I always love coming on here. You're always fun to talk to, and I want to come back sometime and talk some more stuff.
Yeah, man, we're definitely going to – got to get you back on the In-Or-Out Sports Debate. Got to make you a 3-time Vault of Fame inductee. And I'm gonna let things cool down a little bit with the 49ers because it's just a little bit too soon with everything that's going on.
It's a pretty good season for using 4 quarterbacks.
Facts. Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, for what Brock Purdy did, it's just – and when he was throwing the ball, like, in the second half, for him to even come back in the second half just speaks volumes of his testicular fortitude. Okay, for one, but to watch him throw it was in him wincing with that, you know, he's going to need surgery. I just hope, and I haven't heard much about it. I hope it's not going to be Tommy John surgery because that would put him on the shelf for a while. But time will tell. The next 90 days will be big for the NFL when it comes to free agency and the moves they make.
Awesome, man.
So, guys, we've got one thing to announce. Next week, episode 3, the cousin of Roman Reigns, Lance Anoa'i, will be here. Discuss his career with me next Tuesday, 8:05 p.m. Eastern, for episode 3 of the KAYFABE Express. For Greg Anthony, I am Drew Willingham. Thank you, as always, for tuning in for this episode.
Legacy Maker, the All Sports Network, presents a SIRTOBA Media production where the struggle is real to be awesome.
What? You know it.